ago that when we do music camp, there's no point in preparing my sermon 2 weeks in advance as I usually do, because music camp always changes it. It was this week that I was working on my sermon, I took Thursday morning off of camp. I was afraid that I was going to run out of energy and all the rest of that, so I figured it was wise to take some time off on Thursday so that I wouldn't have to on Friday. Like, I tried to predict this thing that I got, and, you know, I don't know, it's like predicting a Kentucky Derby, I guess. That's when I did some preparation. And I got to tell you, I cried and I laughed as I was doing my preparation, because this is the collect for today. This is what made me cry. Almighty God, it's basically, you can get everything Anglican online, by the way, if you ever wonder. Almighty God, your Son Jesus Christ has taught us that what we do for the least of your children, we do also for him. And then it goes, give us the will to serve others as he was the servant of all, who gave up his life and died for us. You know, so there's particularly two phrases in there that really, really struck me. What we do for the least of your children, we do also for him. And of course, here in the prayer, they're not referring just to children chronologically, but you will understand, you know, doing these now. You may have missed it somehow, but I like kids. You know, I enjoy being around kids. I have a lot of fun with it. That we do for the least of your children, we do also for him. And just the notion that as we were serving these kids this week, about 56 of them, everything we did for them, we were doing for Jesus. You know, it just blows my mind. And then it goes on to give us the will to serve others as he was the servant of all. And I'm just going to say, as most of you, I don't think you know this at this point, but you all know that my mind is an interesting place. You might want to take a vacation there, but I really wouldn't advise wanting to take up permanent habitation. It is a place of confusion, sometimes of great light, sometimes of great darkness. There are explosions and fireworks, and there's also a couple of dark closets there that you want to avoid. But my brain, I would say, is an interesting place. And every now and then something comes out of it, and I haven't got any clue where it comes from. And so this week at music camp, for some, I don't know. It would take more psychiatrists than I know to figure out this. I just got into soup. I don't even know where soup appeared. It just happened, hey? It wasn't even like you're singing a song, like soup, 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 soup. We weren't singing a song about it. It's just, all of a sudden, I was on a microphone, and I think I was testing the microphone at the time, and I just went, soup. And then, well, some of you will remember from Oliver the song, "Food, glorious food." You know, well, I don't know. I think there was a synapse or something fired, and it was soup, glorious. And then one of the kids said something like, "Why are you talking about soup?" And you know, I was off to the races with soup. And then I was just like, soup, 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 soup. And it developed. And I knew what was going to happen. And of course it did. And that was that people started bringing soup. You know, and of course I played it up. Once I figured it was an interesting book, I started playing it up. And so kids started bringing soup. And that led into another interesting thing. So what are we going to do with the soup? And I figured, okay, something we've never done. And I felt a little bit funny about it, and I'll tell you why in a minute. But decided that any of the soup that comes in is going to go to my online mission. And so by the end of the week, through various, you know, ways and means, we have probably close to 175 tins of soup, which will last probably between 15 minutes and an hour at the Milan Mission. But I'm going to call up Lori. I'm also going to call up Ross, who's retired now, but you know, she still keeps her... Once you're into social justice, it's not like you're retiring about, you know? She has a life sentence, probably a term life sentence as well. So I'm going to call her up and say just how my brain worked weird, and she knows this. And so as a result, there's going to be over 160 tins of soup going down the Milan Mission. And it was great that as the kids came in, you know, I was able to talk about, you know, people who have needs. And there's people who, even in Montreal, would have been hungry at night and don't have enough to eat. And I didn't want to overplay it or overstate it, but at the same time, it was something worth mentioning. So the second verse that I read here about, you know, willingness to serve others really affected me profoundly as I was reading on Thursday. I didn't want people to feel like we were manipulating them. I have a sincere and real fear of manipulating people. Usually when I manipulate somebody, I say, I'm about to manipulate you. Get ready to be manipulated. And they say, okay, I know I'm about to be manipulated. And then I do, but they've said, okay, so it's, you know, I fear manipulation in many of its ugly forms. And so I don't want people to feel like we're manipulating them into supporting one of our causes, you know. But I do want to encourage the development of that sort of social conscience. So next year, probably somewhere, somehow, in the order of things, we're going to adopt some cause and invite people to bring in soup or pasta or whatever. It may be the year of pasta, and we may have a pasta theme that we use in camp. Who knows? Who knows? But I want to develop that. It's a good thing. So as I was taking my couple of hours off, I was reading the column and just thinking, wow, my sort of limited human experience, my limited human influence and impact, taught us that what we do for the least of your children, we do also for him. Give us the will to serve others as he was the servant of all. Sometimes in the Bible, the word doulos is translated as servant. It really means slave. The word would be slaves to Christ. And servants to others, slaves to Christ. And it is in that attitude that what we do for others, we're doing for Jesus, that we develop this program. So my hope is that as the years go by, and boy are they going by, year 16 of this thing, we manage to connect more and more what we do in music camp with our apostolic responsibility as Christians. You know, and I'm not quite sure how to do that. But I think we need to do that with more intentionality than we have. The genesis of music camp was to connect with the community at a time when art programs and music programs were being cut by the government. They are again, if that's ever stopped. So it's an opportune time, but to be a little bit more overt about what the church stands for and why we stand for it. I think we're there. So that's one thing. That's the heavy. The thing that made me laugh was the first reading for today. Jackie, I'm glad you read that, because if somebody even read it, you read very well, very professionally. So it was easy for me not to laugh. But on Thursday morning, it was Paul talking about how miserable his life was and how much he suffered for the sake of the gospel, and how he had this thorn in the flesh, and three times he asked God to remove his thorn in the flesh, and God had said no three times. And one time when I was in Dio, I remember this, and I hope it is a suitable audience to say this too. We were talking about this thorn in the flesh thing. There were various theories that were popular when I was going through through seminary. Some of them had to do with sexuality, some had to do with disability. And this very, very earnest and very, very elderly theology professor with a long retirement dude just sort of couldn't leave. He said, I am utterly convinced that the Apostle Paul's, he was British, by the way, the Apostle Paul's thorn in the flesh was a severe case of hemorrhoids. And in the context, it was uproarious. It was just absolutely unbelievable. The principal of the college had just introduced everybody who was our special guest, and it was our Wednesday lunch, and this professor had been asked to say grace, and everything was so pretentious. Everything was done pretentiously, and so this professor had said this grace, bless this bunch as we munch this bunch. Amen. And so he liked to take people down a peg when they were being pretentious, and so thus he said about St. Paul's. He may have been right, I don't know. But Paul did pray that God would take away his thorn in the flesh. God did a lot of things for Paul. When you look at Paul's ministry, and when you look at Paul's life, Paul's transformation, Paul's conversion, God did an awful lot of things for Paul. He never took away the thorn in the flesh. Because in some way, I got to be very careful here. Is it okay to say in some way the thorn in the flesh served God's ultimate end? That's not to say that God inflicts suffering on us to teach us a lesson or to control us or to test us or any of the sometimes silly things that people say about that. But if we have a thorn in the flesh, God will not abandon us and say, man, Paul's got hemorrhoids, can't use him, or whatever it was. No, rather he will use us. He will use us as we are. And so you can understand, as I was reading this on Thursday morning, and Paul and the thorn in the flesh, and remembering back to Dio, and knowing that when I return to music camp, I'd be using, you know, my Ferrari. You can understand how I created that a little bit of humor. That despite my increased disability, nonetheless, we're still having music camp. And I'm still having weird ideas, like soup. Want to hear another one of my weird ideas? I had a vision this week. It was not a divine vision. It was not from heaven. It is not a holy vision. It is from completely within my mind. It is also not an evil vision, but it is, I am not in any way ascribing any theological value to this vision, but it was indeed a vision. It was a vision of Bethany and Co. on the roof, throwing things off the roof, and having prearranged, much to her surprise and their surprise, having prearranged with the fire department that at a certain time, the ladder truck would come screaming up to St. Mary's and extend the ladder to our roof and with great ceremony lift all the people who are throwing stuff off the roof onto their ladder and bring them down and then spend half an hour or so talking with kids about the fire department and handing them out stickers and all the fire department does when they're dealing with kids. And I thought that would be cool. Boy, would that be pressworthy, you know? And frankly, that's where I'm going in this sermon. I don't think Paul, in his letters, ever writes anything that parallels the term pressworthy, you know, or clickbait. You know, the internet, they tend to put up these banners and these ads, the goal of which is not to sell you something. The goal of which is to get you to click on that ad so that you're led to the place where they're going to sell you something. Okay, that's called clickbait. Certainly the church, generally, and absolutely St. Mary's, has not in any way capitalized on this notion of clickbait, nor on the notion of pressworthy. I've been listening a lot to CBC. I listen to CBC and CJ, those are the two stations I listen to. And the advertising is very different on both, and the content is very different on both stations. But I gotta tell you, one of the things that amazes me is that on both stations, I would guess about a quarter of what they do in terms of the interviews, the talks, the conversations, has on some level something to do with religion. Now, not necessarily overtly, certainly not in an evangelizing or proselytizing sort of way, but it is absolutely astonishing to me how often religion comes into the conversation. And in fact, a couple of weeks ago, Dan Delmar was doing a thing on CJAD, and if this sounds like shot, if it is, he and I might have a chance to talk about it at some point. He referred numerous times in the course of 1 hour on the exchange thing that he does to white Christian males. You know, he talked about some of the problems in society with racism. It was just after the policeman had killed a black person who was running away. And he referred several times to white Christian males, you know. And I really wanted to call in and say, when you say white Christian males, we all know what white is, we all know what male is. How do you define Christian? Like, are you talking about people who have professed a faith in Jesus Christ? Or are you just talking about people who aren't Jewish or aren't Muslim or aren't anything else? You just automatically lump them into the Christian category. I want to engage that topic at some point in our society. I'm not quite sure how to. But I've been listening to the radio a lot, and what might be a way in here, and what might be a way into the press? I tried several times to get the television stations interested, like Global and CTV, CSF, interested in coming and checking out our music camp. And they never have. I don't know whether it's because summer is just a slow time or because I don't have the personality. I don't know why, but it's never happened. I would have thought that our music camp would be good media, especially during a very slow time, you know? And you know what I suspect? I suspect that because it's a church camp, they don't expect anybody to be interested. You don't see a whole lot of things on television about vacation Bible camps. And dozens and dozens and dozens and dozens of churches have vacation Bible camps. But when people think of church, generally speaking, they think boring. They really do. Boring, irrelevant, and old. You know, that's what they think. Like it or not. And I'm sorry if that's harsh words or offensive words, but that's what people think. They do not think interesting, fun, and happening now. So what do we do? Maybe having a fire engine scream up to our church and stick it out a ladder up to our roof, if they would go for that. Maybe that would, you know, cause the press to come out. And even if it isn't to rescue Bethany from imminent death, Bethany and Caitlin and whoever else from imminent death, maybe they would love to come and do a demonstration. Maybe they'd love to do that. We guaranteed pretty close to 100 kids and parents. Maybe we could invite the parents out for a special thing. You never know. But this I want to say. Reading this collect, I believe in that. I believe in that. I believe that I am called, and you are called, in a way that is unique to me, in a way that is unique to you, to see Jesus in the kids, and to treat them as we would treat Jesus himself. And I believe that I am called, and I believe that you are called in a way that is unique to me, and in a way that is unique to you, to serve all as Christ was serving us all, and to serve Christ, and to serve people as Christ was serving people. I don't see any way out in the New Testament to those obligations. I don't. There are lots of people who copped out. But we're held to account. There is no side door that you can sneak out while Jesus isn't looking. There's only a front door. So if you choose not to do this, you do it in the presence of God. You choose not to do it in the presence of God. I say that. I don't believe there's anybody here, obviously. I don't believe there's anybody here who would say, I don't want to treat children as Jesus would. Nobody would say that. Nobody would say, I don't want to serve people as Jesus would. Nobody would say that. But I got to say, when we look at, you know, time, talent, treasure, those three things, I think all of us, certainly I, probably need some degree of realignment. So that's one thing. I was reading the collect and maybe crying. I felt like that person, I don't know, we wrote it, you know, save me, Lord, the ocean is so big and the boat is so small. I felt like the job was so big and my scooter is so small, you know. But then reading the second thing, with Paul asking for the thorn in the flesh to be removed, and God not removing it. Frankly, I personally found that very affirming, that I am not defined by my disability, but rather, I am to be defined by God's grace working in me and through me. And it's the same for you. You're not defined by your inabilities before God. You're defined by the things that are made possible by Him in and through you. And what wonderful news that is. That's tremendous news. Isn't that a great place to end the sermon? But it's not going to be over, of course not. I got 5 more minutes. This, of course, when I returned in the afternoon of Thursday and on Friday, I returned very much thinking of this collect and Paul's abilities and his disabilities. And I was just looking around at the staff and the volunteers, so a group of people, and just marveling at that's an old word, eh? It sounds like a cheesy word, the word I usually use, but I was at the abilities, just the incredible skill set that is present, and just what the people were capable of. And I was also just not in awe, it wasn't quite as much as awe, but just, I don't know what to say, just looking at the interaction, particularly amongst the leaders, and thinking what a taste of glory it was, in light of a lot of things that I've been listening to on the news lately, that's happening in the world. And then come to this place, and you walk in, and I know it's cliche to say you walk in, you feel the love. But I've got to tell you, you walk in and you feel the love. Like I had gone in the morning, and I, you know, Marie came and got me in the scooter, and then there I am blasting down the walkway. And I think it was first Caitlin that saw me and went, "Lorne!" You know, and then of course I see Miriam after a while. I think I saw you. And one of them went, "Lorne!" Because Miriam said, "Lorne!" As if in like L-O-W-E-R-N. That's my name, as far as Miriam spells it. And Ben's a pipe, you know, off to do the next thing that Ben's. And it's just one person after another. Are you okay? Do you feel better? I didn't feel bad, but do you feel better? You know, because obviously if I'm not there, it's because I'm not feeling well, right? So it was just marvelous, you know, just talk to people and to go into the craft room and just sort of see this group of teenagers, because everybody hates teenagers, can't wait for them to become adults just like us. Sitting around cooperating and talking, that was a bit facetious, by the way. Sitting around talking to one another, just enjoying one another's company, not being disruptive. And one of the kids was up to, was punching into her cell phone, and I said to her, I'll say it exactly, "What the hell is that?" You know? You know, it was, I just sort of freaked her out on purpose, but it was all in fun. And it was just a marvelous place, but you know, I was sort of thinking, wow, Jesus is saying, you know, treat the kids as if they were him, and serve one another as he serves, all that sort of stuff. And you walk into this place during music camp, you actually see it happening. You know, it's not just pie in the sky when you die, you actually see it's happening. And then, of course, what I do is what Lorne usually does. Couldn't just stay in the moment, couldn't just enjoy it. I had to take it further. I had to do the what if, you know, the what's possible, and come up with yet another crazy idea. This time I'm thinking that maybe it's time to start bringing the youth groups together. We're not going to be get them together, toss it around a campfire and sing Kumbaya. That's not going to happen. But you know, social justice issues are very, very much in the public consciousness these days. And so maybe we could get them together to adopt some particular social justice project in the coming season. There's one girl there, she's lovely, her name is Haley. She has people, relatives of me, there's a group of kids from Haiti who are being educated in the Dominican Republic. And she, has she gone down or is she going down? She's
going
down
last year.
Last year, she's going again. Wow, that's fantastic. You start talking to these kids about what they do in terms of social justice. Man, you get some really inspirational stuff. So what about getting a bunch of West Island teenagers together and saying, we, whoever the we becomes, are going to adopt a social justice project. And there you get your opportunity to talk to them, to build relationships and development and all the rest of that sort of thing. And you also get a chance to communicate to their parents, because you can't do this without communicating with their parents as well. Who knows where it's going to lead? And who knows where the music is going? What does it say? You know, I haven't processed this yet. I met this guy at Sarah Rossi's concert. Now, Sarah loves Marie. Sarah loves me. Sarah uses my office, you know, for free during the year to teach music and voice. And she pays us back by doing concert, like when we do a concert, participating in the concert. Sarah is going to be a star. You know, she already is. Is it Oceania she's playing in?
With Patrick Watson.
She's done a gig with Oliver Jones. Like, this person is a star. You know, and she's up and coming. I say jokingly, get her on air right now. But anyway. So she is on sign, and she brought this couple, and this couple sang a song. What does it say that this guy probably mostly through what Sarah has said about Marie Dean and St. Mary's, you know, was something went on that caused him to actually bring this table. And it's an offering. You know, it is an offering. It's an offering to me, not to God. It's an offering to me. And there's this lovely little note on the box. I don't want to throw the box up because the note is quite firmly attached to the box about making music. Like, something happened there. I'd love to know exactly what it was. But if it happened in him, what can we do to trigger a response far and wide? Okay, so, in one sense, this sermon has been basically a random collection of thoughts based on a collect that made me cry and a reading about a disabled apostle who nonetheless served God with his life and in his death. I hope I serve God in my death as well, but that's for hopefully in the future. But it led me to say, you know, what is possible? Like, what is possible if we really truly dedicate ourselves to connecting with the community around us and maximizing the opportunities that God presents? Just to finish, and I mean just to finish, another thing we heard was about Jesus setting up the disciples to wait. You know, this was new. This was not the Jewish way of doing things. The Jewish way is welcome, but not evangelism. And Jesus sent them out, and there's different versions of this story with different amounts of detail, but he sent them out, two by two. And the message is, even the demons obey. You know, when you go out in the love of God, with his message, even the demons tremble. If we truly dedicated ourselves to building God's kingdom through whatever means and resources that he has entrusted to our care, this incredibly skilled and able congregation, what would be possible? You know, next year, I'm going to be 60. I will have been doing this since my mid-40s, if my math is right. I don't know how many more years I got of active ministry, but I gotta tell you, whatever number I have left, whatever number you have left, I know that God uses. I know he will. And I know that he is so anxious to use us to build his kingdom for the benefit of his children. Let's pray now. God, you offer so much, and we are so easily distracted. As we remember and celebrate the joys and the challenges, because there were some of those, and music and we thank you for all you do to inspire us to discipleship. And God, I pray for your church. You know, the call is so big and the boat is so small. Let us know specifically what it is that you want us to do in this church and through this church. And give us the focus to take advantage of the opportunities that you created for us. And God, as always, thank you for the many, many people who support us in what we're trying to do. God, we pray for your world, for the lost, the lonely, the hungry, the hurting, the marginalized. And we pray for those who care for them. And God, I pray for those who care, remember ourselves. Lord, bless this church, bless our ministry, and more.